Good evening. Welcome to West 57th. Our first story tonight contains new and startling information that indicates the American government got involved in smuggling drugs to supply the Nicaraguan Contras. That's right, drug smuggling organized by the CIA to support the Contras. Congress is already investigating the covert network set up by the White House and the CIA to secretly supply the Contras with guns and money. But tonight you'll hear from three men who say, as incredible as it sounds, that the government, through the sale of marijuana and cocaine, helped fund that secret war. The basic scheme, confirmed in 36 interviews, was simple. Fly weapons down to the Contras, using the same planes and pilots, secretly fly drugs back to the United States, then sell the drugs and use the proceeds to buy more weapons for the Contras. To keep the Contras armed and fighting, according to the Tower Commission, the White House started the secret weapons network in 1984. Those organizing the gun shipments included former and current CIA operatives. But what wasn't in the Tower Commission report is that among those recruited to fly weapons to Central America were known drug traffickers.
We're talking about millions and millions of dollars.
Do you really believe the government decided to get into the drug business in order to pay for the Contras? The American government.
As incredulous as it may sound, I believe that not only decided to get into it, I think they orchestrated the whole thing.
Mike Tolliver is a pilot whose principal occupation has been smuggling drugs. He's currently serving a 3.5-year sentence in a federal prison in Miami for a conviction unrelated to the secret flights he made for the Contras. He says he was approached in 1985 by longtime CIA operatives to run what they called supplies.
It was military supplies, and I didn't have to be a real dummy not to figure out what that was.
What did you think it was?
Guns, ammunition for the Contras, and that as an extra added bonus, we could either freelance on the way back.
Meaning what?
Well, meaning we could bring back our own cargo, and they would arrange it, or we could bring back their cargo without ever having to worry about interception, arrest, anything like this. But everything was taken care of.
What kind of cargo were you talking about?
Drugs.
What kind of drugs?
Whatever you wanted, marijuana, cocaine.
Whatever you want to come back with, fine. We can make sure you don't get
caught. We can make sure. It was my understanding that they would make sure we wouldn't get caught. They were providing not only the cargo, but the landing areas, crews, everything.
For drug runs?
Yeah.
They would also provide the drugs if you wanted.
Absolutely, which indeed they did.
Why would the CIA allow drug planes to come into the United States loaded with coke for the U.S.?
Money.
George Morales, the leader. Here in the 1983...
George Morales is a world champion boat racer. He is also a world-renowned cocaine trafficker, whose empire extended from Colombia to Miami. Morales was indicted for running cocaine in 1984. He says the CIA used his indictment to pressure him into providing planes, pilots, and $3 million in cash to the Contras. He, too, is in federal prison awaiting sentencing on the 84 charge. You're saying drug planes were allowed into the States as long as somebody was taking some money into the Contra coffer?
Definitely.
Is this like just a one-time occurrence?
No.
Somebody snuck in?
No.
Frequent?
Yes.
Routine?
Yes.
Believe it or not, the entire business is compartmentalized. You've got, I'm like a teamster. You know, I'm in transportation. You've got people that are in loading. You've got people that are in offloading. You've got people that are in distribution. People that are in sales. You know, it's like an IBM situation.
Tolliver says he had two meetings with this man, Rafael Quintero, a veteran CIA contract agent who was coordinating secret weapons flights for the covert network. Then Tolliver made two flights. In March of 1986, he was instructed to fly to Honduras. He landed at the airstrip at Aguacate, a Contra resupply base set up by the CIA.
We had about 28,000 pounds of military supplies, guns, ammunition, things like that.
And when you landed in Honduras, no checking, no customs, no inspection?
Well, I didn't think the customs people were going to be out there in the jungle, to be honest with you.
What kind of cargo were you bringing back?
25,000 and change pots.
25,000 pounds
yes.
Of pot?
Marijuana. Same plane.
And same people you believe set you up with the arms?
Exactly.
Oh, of course. That also set you up with the
25,000
pounds of pot?
And change, yeah. That's what the piece paper they gave me said 25, I think, 360.
So what do you do with that 25,000 pounds of pot?
We take off from Tegucigalpa, Honduras, and we leave.
To?
South Florida.
Where in South Florida?
We landed at Homestead.
Homestead?
Air Force Base.
You brought 25,000 pounds of marijuana and landed it at Homestead Air Force Base?
That's correct.
With whose clearance?
I was given a discreet transponder code to SWAT about 2 hours south of Miami. I received my instructions from the ground for traffic separation and told them what my destination was.
What did you say?
I told them we were a non-scheduled military flight into Homestead Air Force Base.
What happened when you landed?
We landed about 1:32 o'clock in the morning, I guess, and a little blue truck came out and met us, and it had a little white sign on it that said, follow me.
And you did?
Two flashing lights, and we followed it.
To where?
Some area of the field. I have no idea. I've never been there before or since.
Were you surprised you were going to land all this pot at
Well, I was a little taken aback, to be honest with you. I was somewhat concerned about it. I figured it was a setup. They were going to, you know, or it was a DEA bust or a sting or something like that.
And instead, nothing happened to you?
No, the little guy in the truck puts in the pickup truck and takes us out, and I get on his taxi cab.
Did you get paid for the flight?
$75,000.
Tolliver identifies this as the plane he flew. The plane traces to a company that was hired by the government to fly humanitarian supplies to the Contras. At the same time, Tolliver made his flight. How do you know the CIA was aware of these drug planes entering the state?
They actually saw the transaction.
They saw the drug transaction?
Yes.
You mean like unloading a plane full of coke or
yes.
What? They saw that?
Yes.
Here in the state?
No.
Where?
Out of the state.
Central America?
Yes.
According to Morales and seven other sources, weapons from the United States were shipped here to northern Costa Rica, only miles from the Contra War. They say the planes landed at several airstrips controlled by this man, John Hull, a CIA operative placed by the Tower Commission in several meetings with Oliver North. A half dozen sources call Hull a key player in North's secret weapons network. They say it was under Hull's direction that the guns were taken off the planes and the cocaine loaded on, destined for the United States.
There's never been any drug movement through this zone or through any of our farms, because on each farm, the foreman has a log of every airplane that lands, of all the movements that's made there. And we have kept these not for me, but for the Costa Rican narcotics people.
It's kept by your employees. Ostensibly, if you're any good at doing this kind of thing, you wouldn't put it in the log.
I'm not that good, Jane. There's never been anyone land here that I didn't know exactly who they were.
You are aware of planes loaded with drugs and planes loaded with weapons landing and using the airstrips of John
Hull? Yes, I'm aware of that.
Did they do this in the middle of the night? Perhaps they did it and he wouldn't be aware of it? Is it possible?
Basically, in the middle of the day.
Middle of the afternoon?
Yes.
Broad daylight?
Yes.
How much was he getting for each landing when you would come through with a drug plane?
That I'm aware of, $300,000.
I took two loads, small aircraft loads, of weapons to John Hull's ranch in Costa Rica and returned back to Florida with approximately 1,000 kilos of cocaine.
1,000 kilos of cocaine?
Yeah, 500 each trip.
Gary Betzner was one of George Morales' top pilots. He, too, was in federal prison in Miami on an unrelated drug conviction. His sentence is 15 years. Like Morales and Tolliver, he has little to gain from talking about these drug flights. None of what they say here will shorten their sentences for their other convictions.
Who would load that cocaine down in Costa Rica? Who would accept the weapons? Who would load cocaine?
Most people that were hired by John Hull or working for him would load the aircraft. In both cases, John Hull was there. And
he physically saw the weapons coming in?
Physically saw the weapons coming in.
Did he physically see the cocaine going out?
He physically saw the bags.
How did you know you were landing with the right strip?
Because I was communicating by radio.
And they were expecting you?
Mm-hmm.
So you called in?
Mm-hmm.
You said, this is Mr. Betzner, and I have
No. I just called in, and I went. And a whistle came back. Right? And I said, I'm 20 minutes out, or whatever. I said, okay. And I landed.
Where did the cocaine come from?
The cocaine was there when we offloaded the weapons, because they had the fuel on the same truck with the coke. Second trip I went down, I didn't go back into John Hull's place. I went into another strip, was maybe 10 or 15 miles east of the place, a little better strip.
What What exactly was in the plane that you flew from Fort Lauderdale?
Well, there was some C-4 explosives, M-60 machine gun, and it was stacked all the way to the ceiling.
How many pounds of weaponry?
I would estimate around 2,500 pounds.
Well, I understood right away it wasn't the private guns that went down that were that important. It was what was coming back that could buy much larger and better and more sophisticated weapons. And it was unaccounted for cash.
When you were first approached by the CIA and the Contras, how was that approach made? What did they say to the best of your recollection? When was it?
Well, it was right after my indictment in 1984, March 1984. They came to my office. Before that, I have a few meetings with not high-level Contras.
You've been doing business with the Contras?
Yes.
But all of a sudden, somebody bigger shows up at your office here in Miami.
Very, very big, yes.
What was the rank? What level CIA person?
Well, he is the contact directly with the CIA and the Contras. He was sort of the advisor. He worked for the CIA at the beginning with.
Do you know George Morales?
Yes, I know George Morales.
Octaviano Cesar is the man Morales says recruited him to run guns and drugs. Cesar is now an official for a Contra group in Costa Rica.
So what you wanted from Morales was trained in cash.
Aid, any type of
money.
Because if you didn't have the plane, you needed the cash to go and buy the plane. You needed the plane so you can bring in the supplies.
In addition to Morales, 8 separate sources confirm his CIA connection.
What is your relationship with the CIA? Your personal relationship?
None.
Never?
None.
When he said that he checked this with Washington in high levels, what did that mean? What kind of high levels?
So he would speak directly with, well, he told me that he directly speak with Vice President Bush about my situation.
About clearing up your indictment?
Yes.
On drug dealing charges?
Yes.
He told you directly that he
yes.
spoke with Vice President Bush
that
about taking care of your
yes.
problems?
He did. Also, William Casey.
How do you know that the CIA person that says, look, help us out, give us some money, give us some air support, let us use some of your planes, train us some pilots, we'll help you with your indictment. And by the way, you know, I've talked to Vice President Bush and CIA Director Casey about your problems. How do you know he wasn't just a boaster, just a baloney artist?
I knew what relationship he had with Washington people, and he's very well known, not only by the United States, but also the government of Costa Rica.
Yeah. He says that he agreed to pay $250,000 a quarter to the Contra cause and to donate planes if you offered protection and help for him in terms of his drug charge.
That's absolutely false. Absolutely false.
Where did the money go? What type of arrangements would be made to receive this money? Who'd actually have to
some money went sent through banks, some money went sent directly cash money to them.
He would hand over cash to whom?
To the Contra himself.
In what form? Pack it up in a suitcase?
Yes, boxes, suitcases, box.
A cash?
Yes.
How much in one load? I mean, how much would you pack into a bag or a suitcase or a box?
I don't recall.
Thousands?
Yes.
Tens of thousands?
Yes.
Hundreds of thousands?
Yes.
In one single trip to a bank in the Bahamas, George Morales and Octaviano Cesar brought back $400,000. U.S. Customs records confirm this. Octaviano Cesar signed the declaration. If you were to guess how much money the CIA raised by hitting up drug dealers for drug money, how much would that be total in 1984, 1985, 1986?
A lot of money.
What's a lot of
directly
money?
Directly and indirectly, a lot of money. Millions of dollars that I'm aware of.
Given your experience, who do you figure arranged all of this? What's your best guess?
My best guess would be that it had to be someone in either the top four three slots of the CIA, as I know their organization. It has to be someone that high up. It has to be.
Why?
Because who else can you get that's going to know, number one, the inner working thing, but they can come pick up the phone and say, let this happen.
Who did pick up the phone to say, let this happen? We can only tell you who says they didn't. The Air Force says it has no record of Mike Tolliver's flight into Homestead Air Force Base. The White House denies knowledge of drug smuggling, but points out they can't speak for Oliver North. Oliver North refuses so far to speak for himself. Vice President Bush says he never heard of George Morales or Octaviano Cesar. And the CIA says, quote, It strictly observes U.S. law. Drug smuggling is against the law, end quote. Mike Tolliver, George Morales, and Gary Bechner will testify before Congress next month.